welcome everybody here to your stream of the MLG TKO. I am your host, Tobiwan.
And I'm the capitalist.
And we are back here. It's been a while, Cap. I've been putting up my toes, relaxing over the week. So I actually technically be doing other work apart from casting. But we get to be back here to cast up some awesome Dota, some American Dota too. Mm-hmm. So it's your home turf, man. You just need to have like the... What are your colors? The
what? Excuse me? What are our colors? The red, white, and blue.
Sorry, all I see is blue and white, and all of a sudden I'm like, hey, Australian colors.
You
a little
disgust
bit.
Me.
I was like, look at that little gold tint that comes in all of a sudden. You're Australia. Yeah, sorry. We're here for America, is what we're casting tonight. So we're going to be kicking off with, I'd say kicking off, we actually have a double header in a double header engagement, just to make it even more complicated for you. So Cloud9 are playing two-game series. Is what's coming up this evening. They're starting up against Team eHug, which I think we can rank as the third best team in America. Maybe the fourth best team in America.
If you're separating Cloud9 from the rest of...
I'm putting Cloud9 as
an international team?
Yeah.
Okay, and then you have EG on top, Team Liquid is second, and yes, eHug is the third. Then yes, absolutely.
Yes, yes. eHug, the guys who actually have a team house with everybody at the team house.
And still a third, but they're making their way.
They're working there. They've got a great roster. Like, we've got tonight, Palin will be playing for them, but they've been looking really good. I like these guys. They bring a spice. They bring a level of aggression. They bring some confidence and focus, which is all I really ask from a team which is battling up against a team which really they are the clear underdogs against.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, Cloud9 have been looking so good. Team EG as well. You know, when you're in a group with those sort of teams, you know, you're going to drop some games. And maybe, you know, people start underestimating you, looking, you know, seeing eHug and seeing their past games and go, oh, look at all these losses, you know, all that sort of thing. But it's against eHug. It's against Cloud9. It's against Evil Geniuses. Hell, it's even against Team Liquid. Those are some tough teams to face up against. And honestly, you should not underestimate these guys. I think that... given time, I mean, honestly, raw talent is usually not an issue when it comes to the Dota scene. Mainly, it's just teamwork. Drafting is a big part of that, but innovation as well, very, very big in the Dota scene. So if these guys can just stick together, get that teamwork going, I think they've got plenty of talent to their name.
I was going to share right now that that's not what I want to do. I want to do this. To Dry Ranger. May we have a wonderful game. It's going to be amazing.
Now I'm plugged in.
Really?
It's like, why can't I hear myself? There we go.
Obviously, the most disturbing thing in your life. Wake up in the morning. Why can't I hear myself? Check. Yeah. Yeah. But Dry Ranger, coming up for Cloud9. Man, do I wish my set was already completed by now. This hero is all over the scene. We're seeing her in China. We're seeing her all across America. I know, for example, Illidan won't stop playing it for Virtus Pro. So, yeah.
And it's going to fall off at the exact time that your Draw Ranger set comes out. I hope you know that. I hope you're ready
for
that.
It won't. It'll be amazing. She'll be eternally, like, forever awesome. Mm-hmm. And Ice Frog's just going to go, you know, Draw Ranger's getting some decent play. And then Nerfa! He's going to do that.
That's exactly what's going to happen.
Yeah. I think Ice Frog personally just has a vendetta against Drow Ranger, just because like he must have been like a big fan of Wind Ranger. And so, well, there just can like only really be proper one run. Well, there's only one real Ranger. Mm-hmm. And obviously Ice Frog is like impartial to Redhead. So
there are certain heroes that Ice Frog does seem to get stuck on. Either hates them or either loves them. Tree and Protector is always the one that I constantly bring up. Like, Ice Frog just won't give up on that hero.
He loves
that
hero.
I'll make that hero work.
But he does. He does now.
Like, he does work. After iteration of Tree and Protector with different abilities, we finally have one.
I actually think Dry Ranger is in the same scenario. Like, you remember the buff that came to Dry Ranger? Like, we're talking back in 2012, the buff that came to Dry Ranger, which was just this aura.
Yep.
Which was so damn strong. It is etched in my memories to see what the Filipinos did with that Drow Ranger and Puck combination. They ran Puck in an offlane, and he had more DPS than any other hero on the map. Even more than Drow Ranger was just sitting down in the bottom lane. And they just went, like, it was basic boots and Dagon on this Puck. And he just went around the map killing off everybody because this was like physical harassment, orb would hit, join it, boom! And that was basically, and you're like, hey, hang on, what the crap's going on? That shouldn't be possible. But that used to be the aura of Draw Ranger. But
yeah,
she got nerfed up a little bit more, but I know you enjoy her in push strats now with the way her with her aura triggers on and off.
Absolutely. Any sort of minion push strat works really, really well with Drown Ranger. The same way that teams have been experimenting with Lycan, Drown Ranger fills a similar role in that you're both heavy physical damage dealers. Both of you are pretty squishy to certain initiations. If you get jumped on and disabled up, you're going to have a bad time. But you also are able to have abilities that augment minion pushes and make them much, much stronger than they normally are. So I've enjoyed seeing it. I think that that aura, especially when you actually use it, I think sometimes you have people just completely forget about it. You do actually have to press the button, and creeps will get that extra bit of damage.
Exhibit
but
A.
When you do use it, it's very, very strong. And you can see Cloud9, they're actually, this is interesting. I like the Naga Siren takeaway just because of the fact that that kind of initiation would be devastating, right? I think that using that sleep offensively up against Cloud9, you've got a lot of squishy heroes here that are very, very susceptible to that kind of initiation. If you allow a team to get close quarters with you, you're going to have a really, really hard time fighting up against that. So I like that one. Lycan as well is a good single target damage dealer with his max movement speed and everything else. If he just locked on to the Drow Ranger, very little she could do about it.
Yeah, it's not even just like him, like his wolves and himself locking on that, but when you got the slow coming out from Dazzling, you get the bonus damage coming out from the Ancient Apparition, these guys can make almost any lane work for them. So, yeah, I'm not surprised too. You got to remove out the ability to be very over-aggressive on heroes and diving on heroes, and the ability to control them coming into that mid-game, because that's when Cloud9's really going to hit their sweet spot. Visage gets levels, Mirana gets levels, and Drow Ranger, you know what happens when she cracks level 11. The world just fears for their life. And Team eHug go with a way which I'm not quite sure is going to be as successful. It's going to be the Magnus trying to get in. And the only reason why I'm a little bit uncertain about the Magnus is because you're still having to get in range of Drow Ranger and get your combo off.
Right.
Now, normally you just say Blink Dagger as well as Arcane Boots and a Magnus and you're good to go. You can rush up the Blink Dagger now because the way they change it with the mana cost, so Mag can just skip the mana boots, but obviously that cripples him in the lane, so he must run a bottle. But it's the fact that he jumps in. If Drow Ranger is fast enough, and I'm going to say he is for the sake of what's probably going to happen, and that Gust comes off straight away, Mag will never get his ulti off properly.
Yeah.
He jumps into these fights, you get an elusive hero like Drow Ranger can make some space like that, and then you're going to have a Mirana who can leap away, a Visage who's even going to screw up the Blink Dagger from the start with the Familiars, and now you get one of the most slippery little dragons in the game, and that's a Puck coming up as the first fourth pickup. Not to mention, everyone's just lapping up this bonus. The only thing we're missing right now is a Luna, but that would mean that we have a Visage and Mirana support.
Yeah, I was going to mention that. The fact that you were talking about the Puck earlier, Puck is one of those heroes who really, really benefits from those kind of... that extra bit of physical damage actually makes you a bit of a terror because you mix in the magic damage plus you're throwing out a lot of auto attacks. Makes Puck very, very fearsome. Mirana as well is another hero who benefits hugely off of this because it's always been that she has very, very lackluster physical damage. And Drow Ranger will be able to buff that up. And now I see no issues whatsoever with Mirana. If you have a Drow Ranger, if you have a Lycan on your team, running a Mirana as a semi-carry I think is a great idea.
What?
But Team eHug, though, they're going full on initiative. And they're going full on wombo combo. You see that they picked up the Batrider because they just love running the Batrider anyway. But they also have the initiation of a Magnus. Mm-hmm. Now they're going with the Faceless Void as well. These are all really, really good going up against range squishy heroes. That if you're able to get the initiation, you can wipe this team pretty easily.
Okay. The problem I'm seeing with this, and bear with me on this, I'm not seeing the synergy between the three cores of Team eHug. Chrono cripples Magnus as well as the Batrider, Dazzle as well as Ancient Apparition as well. They're not going to be there going, hey RP, here's our follow-up. It won't be there. The only combination you can hope for is when Mag actually gets freezed up. So you get the Firefly out to start with, then you get the Mag RP on top of the Firefly area, and then Batrider's outside the Chrono sticky napalming, and then Faceless Void jumps in with the Battle Fury and does his cleave damage.
Mm-hmm.
And all of this requires a huge amount of farm when C9, their lineup is beautiful to counter up against Faceless Void, as well as giving the aura. I know I said Luna was a joke because I was thinking, what other aura can we stack up here? But with a Vengeful Spirit aura And she's got swap too. Mm-hmm. So saving someone from inside that chrono is going to be so much easier for him. Yeah, I'm very apprehensive at saying I am happy with the eHug lineup. I would be, yeah.
Okay, I see what you're saying about the... Look, you're right. There isn't a whole lot of synergy between the Mag Void. Like, you can't have situations where you get this really good RP and then Void jumps in, throws down a Chronosphere, and because he has Battle Fury Maelstrom, he can do a decent amount of damage. But you're right. They do block each other in many different ways. However, against a team like Cloud9, you're not going to be able to just be able to have one big wombo combo, like your perfect ideal of everything that you want to be able to happen. You know, Black Hole, Dark Seer,
it works for this game. Else.
Yeah, Showcase View does work now, by the way.
Oh, does it? For all?
That is always working now.
I'm just, oh, that's amazing. Look at the set he's got. I love this hood.
You know, that's great. That's great and all, Toby. But
we should focus on the game.
But you should be a little jelly because I got the chance to witness Fear and the first time he rolled out his free-to-play Sven set. Showcase View worked for that one, too.
Fine.
Anyway, so what I was saying is basically you're looking at so much initiation. There is some good synergy, however, between the Batrider and the Void. Because Batrider jumps in, grabs a hero, four-staffs his way back, and there's going to be response. Cloud9, they will group up and they will try and respond to save that hero. They move forward, and that's when the Void finds his counter-initiation. As they move forward to save that one hero trying to initiate, that's when Void jumps in and throws down his AoE. However, Vengeful Spirit is a big, big block here. Basically, being able to have that swap destroys both Chronosphere and Batrider's initiation, which is really, really bad.
I'm almost waiting for the time, too, when RP is used in the middle of absolutely nowhere. It's like, blinks in, deafening blast, pushes him back. He's like, now I'm going to go for my... Boom. Gone. We get a quick pause coming out here from Mirana. He just got one deny against him in the middle lane, so Sing Sing just DCs out in complete rage of this. But you could barely off to a great start in the mid. 0-1 on that Magnus.
Jigabelly, this is going to be a pretty tough lane for him. I mean, in like Mirana, low on physical damage until you have an extra 9 coming out from that Draw Ranger. And then you're looking at 60 base and you're like, wow, actually Mirana hits very, very hard now. Like she's hitting just as hard as, in fact, harder than the Magnus in lane. That's just kind of absurd because Mirana is supposed to be low on physical damage. So that's where that Draw Ranger is really going to kick in up to lane for both middle and bottom as well. You're talking about the puck off lane. That's exactly how Cloud9 are going to be running it. And heroes like Ancient Apparition by themselves are not going to be able to force out puck because you'll just be able to turn some of that damage. And with phase shift and just auto attacks, you'll actually be able to output a lot more if Chilling Touch isn't up. Now, Amacheep does have a double damage. That's a great start. But I don't really see how they're going to be able to win their lanes here.
Yeah, I'm with you on this one, man. It's I just want to wait and see the first rotation, really. If this comes out from C9 or if this ends up coming out from eHug, I want to see this AA as well as Dazzle do something more than zone out a puck a little bit. Like, Chilling Touch and DD is great, but Bone7's still going to find his experience in this lane, and I don't think I'm a Sheepstuck's really intended to do that by dragging half of the creep wave over the side. But these lane matchups, I'm not seeing the beauty and the passiveness to come out from eHug. They're not going to get the advantage early on. Faces Void takes so long before he really sets up that even by level 6, Bone7, easy join away, but by level 6, Draw Ranger is going to be taking out that top tower. And they're giving Eternal Envy all the space in the world. Aoi's doing pull-throughs with Pile I Die. And what are these supports getting in the bottom lane? Zoning out Bone7? He doesn't care. Because once the T1 tower goes in the top lane, he gets all the money he really desires. And they can just start moving into different objectives as well. It's only going to take a quick support rotation from Visage as well as the VS to get a kill on either AA or Dazzle.
Yeah, Jigabelly, he's going to have to use his skewer defensively here and try and get out of this situation.
Yeah, this is not going to be great. VS done, jumps in. He's actually waiting on the arrow and wait just a little bit too long. Jigabelly is able to skewer himself up and away. And the supports can hunt Tim down and just make him waste time while Sing Sing will keep
farming. Yeah, he's got to deny himself to creeps here. This is his only option. He needs to get back in the lane as soon as possible, so he's doing the smart thing. Kills himself to the neutrals, going to buy TP scroll, get right back in the lane. Dodges the gank. I mean, that was a great play from Jigglebilly. I think that was a bit of a mistake there from Sing Sing, but it goes to show, like, these supports, I know you want to be able to see them from the eHug side, move around the map and try and gank and put some pressure on Cloud9, but honestly, they just don't have the supports that are going to be successful at that.
Yeah.
If they had some sort of a stunner in mid instead of a Magnus, like Magnus is not really a big playmaker for that mid lane. Until he picks up level 6, he has zero kill potential unless you make a mistake. So having two heroes rotate in with a slow and some extra auto attack damage, that's not going to be enough to kill Sing Sing.
No, they're not the playmaker heroes that you normally look for as a support guy. So the guys that set the tone, you look for these wonderful utility abilities. Like the poison starts early on. When Bone 7 does such a small jump like that, then they get a small chance to attack him, but he phase shifts out one part of the damage and then just backs up. They can't kill him. And even then, you got to wait a little bit longer. Looks like Sing Sing is having a bit of a rough time in mid lane up against Jigglebilly. But he's bottling up, so he'll be okay. But yeah, this lineup from eHug, you're right. I'm getting a little bit sidetracked with my own thoughts right now, where I'm looking for them to try and contest these lanes, realizing they're falling behind, realizing they're not going to hit their timing before C9's going to do it. But I have to remember, with this eHug lineup, it's not designed to fight yet.
No.
It's designed to go for the wombo combo later in this game. It's not meant to fight now. The only thing which Armor Sheep sucks, as well as our Dazzle play by Pandago, need to do is keep pulling experience out of this jungle. They need to find their higher levels, because the rest of C9, they're going to find their levels from the kills when they rotate around. Like, we're already just watching AoE2000 looking for that TP up towards top lane to try and stop this push. But the second somebody comes up here, they're basically dead. And AoE2000, he's going to snipe a courier too. Oh, I don't know if he's actually enough damage. No, he doesn't. He's only going to get 3 hits off.
Yeah, but look at top. You actually have Jigglebilly making a really early rotation here, but they did see the invis being picked up. He wanted to try and snipe off Draw Rager, who was low enough with a skewer into tower plus a shockwave combo. Mm-hmm. He'd be able to kill her, but you know, there was a rune there, and you got to expect that. You didn't counter any river runes. You're not going to be able to make some sort of big rune play like that when they have vision up. So that was kind of a silly rotation, and Pendago may go down in mid.
Oh, that's actually, yeah, Batride's going to come out and try and slow him down. It's a quick shallow grave, which means Sing Sing Starfall doesn't get the kill, poisons him up. He's going to try and juke it around the tree line here. Sing Sing sees him quickly, but now lost him in the tree line. AoE2000 underneath the tower almost got the kill over on the Batrider, but ends up losing his own life while Mirana denies himself off to a neutral. So we go 2-1 with that engagement, which is rather deep in.
Yeah, that was a little bit silly, and this is actually gives Cakes a huge advantage now. He was not doing the greatest in jungle. He missed, I believe, one stack because of this, but he just got that first blood gold. He now has Tranquil Boots. He's going to be building into that faster Blink Dagger, which is so necessary for the strategy beat, because once you get the full-on 5-manning coming out from Cloud9, where I don't think they're actually going to go for much 5-manning necessarily, but just looking at the early to mid-game, they have a lot of power coming out of their lineup, a lot of really fast damage that they can output.
Oh, he tried to actually play Silly Buggers with I'm a Sheep Sucks there and delay the arrow and just try to stutter step it, but doesn't really work for him at the end of the day. Man, I think they really should have put Jigglebilly up here even earlier than this. He's managed to find his level 6. He's finding some really good farm up here. Even if you do count as a foul rotation gank, they're getting so many more levels over an Ancient Apparition. Ancient Apparition, as well as Dazzle, have basically gone up by a level and a half in just the last minute because of this rotation out. I'm loving this. Their transition in is going to get even stronger. And with Jigglebilly managing to grab a haste rune as well, middle tower is under attack. Where's he actually headed?
Oh,
the Dire Observer was watching him. They're going to try and force a fight up here on the top lane. The TP comes in from Pandago. AoE2000 we spotted over here on the side. The arrow's coming in from the Mirana and hit him! He's also been gusted back, and Sing Sing somehow was able to connect, and Pandago comes in way too close. Shallow Grave won't protect him here. Look at it. Envy's trying to wait it out almost perfectly. Keeps him slow. Gets the last hit in. 2 for the price of 0. And they might even try and get another one here. AoE2000 was frosted up for a bit, but Ancient Apparition, 68 life points. They lose the top tower. And just one mistake, one Observer would watch the rotation, and eHug have a horrible engagement on top.
Again, you can't make those sort of plays. You can't just assume that somehow they don't have wards up, that they don't have vision, unless you've countered something. If somebody, if a support lets you know, hey, I killed a rune ward, then maybe you can think about making that sort of play. But honestly, that was just the feature of that play was just the amazing arrow coming out from Sing Sing. That was beautifully paced to like kind of track a hasted hero like that and hit an arrow.
Oh,
like
bottom lane, close. Another 5 second arrow. Bone 7's going to follow up with his own silencer. No, he's not going to kill Secure. He tried to. But Mirana will take the kill. So we hit 4-2. Pendega was still here on the bottom lane, just watching from afar.
They're not sticking to their strengths. They're not sticking to their strengths, which was they have very harassive support heroes. Keep out the off lane, go for pulls. If you're going to put Ancient Apparition in mid, I think that was a great idea. Play passive, pick up level 6. Don't try and make the plays right now. You don't have the heroes designed for it. They have more mid-game oriented pick-off heroes. They can't actually make any plays right now.
Yep, agreed. And they even set yourself back even further, man. Your mid-game oriented heroes, power net, while his CS looking great, he picked up a hand of Midas early on, so he's even more useless here in the early stage of the game.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I really like Midas on Faceless Void. However, this is if you're going to go for a Midas, again, it's one of those things you need to be actually sitting there in lane making sure that your carry is not getting picked off like that. And an arrow going down, like, you need to have laning vision. It's up now, but it's after the pickoff of Power Knot, who was really the only silver lining right now for this very, very dark storm of a game for eHug. He was free farming, and now him dying once puts him back quite a bit.
Look at Sing Sing prepping that bottom lane.
Yeah.
He really is the arrow master. He wants this to fly perfectly down this line and connect with Void roughly in this box. That's his goal right now.
He needs extra rotations, though.
Yeah.
It can't be just him by himself. There's just no way.
Yeah. And if he uses Leap to initiate in, then he is completely dead.
Yeah.
But so here is coming. It's Bone 7.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he's just setting himself up for when Bone 7 comes in. Bone 7 has a lot of farm. Do you realize this? He almost has a Blink Dagger already. Just straight up Blink is what he's going for.
But you notice the hilarious thing is it's only 14-1 on him. Like, it's just because he hasn't died at all on this offlane support.
Oh, look at this. Beautiful. They pop Moonlight Shadow and go in invis past the ward. They have no idea what's about to hit them.
They still need the line of sight for the arrow. Look at the sentry wall is just coming around the side. If they try and loop themselves up, it's not going to work. But then again, they need to have the vision. The creep wave's going to do it for them. They saw Sing Sing for a quick moment. Now they both walk back past that observe ward going, hey. But the moments have arrived now for eHug. They get Blink Dagger on Batrider. I'm not going to say Arcane Boots is the be-all, end-all of Alakazam for Jigglebilly, but he is reaching a point now where he's going to become a lot more prominent in the lanes. And if that Batrider can get some good initiations off, then it's C9 that get caught out. But I'm still seeing a Drow Ranger who's running that Hand of Midas nice and early, because it's all about levels first. She doesn't care about the money. The money can come in, but once she gets level 16, that Hand of Midas can be sold. But yeah, Drow Ranger, she is going to get so fat right now. It's 69-4 on Drow Ranger. Like, they're not controlling her at all. Eternal Envy can solo carry this entire eHug team as long as there's just a couple of support heroes that hover around him, like Pilot Eye is doing now. One swap, Drow Ranger gets some space, Faceless Void will die inside of his own chrono.
Yeah, but at the same time, Faceless Void is a very, very good carry up against Drow Ranger because you have an ability to get close up. You have Bash inherently in your skill set, so if you just get some attack speed, you can lock down that enemy hero. And, of course, his big ultimate is a great teamfight ability. So I do think that, for the most part, Cloud9 do have much, much better early to mid-game teamfight. There are some opportunities for eHug to kind of exploit some of their pickoff potential that they have, but I do think that Cloud9 are going to be winning most of these teamfights. However, going into late game, if eHug can just go for enough pickoffs here, eHug actually has a really strong late game lineup because they have very greedy supports. They have a very, very strong offlaner in Batrider to be able to help out the Faceless Void. All you want is extra control when you have a hero like Faceless Void. And Magnus is it really augments that carry ability of a Faceless Void.
You see exactly, though, how C9 deal with this. You're talking about the late game potential of eHug, and then you get a Mask of Madness on Drow Ranger. Now, This is only picked up when you want to murder people, left, right, and center. If not, you go into just the casual Yasha. You look for your stat gain on agility, and you start like beating down on the enemy. Or you look for other forms of DPS. Now, they're going to smoke up. I don't know if this meant for a gank on the bottom lane, or if they're considering Roshan.
Yeah,
and
Roshan.
They're going to hook themselves in around the cliff line. So in they come for Roshan with the Mask of Madness. They don't really have some great tanks for this. Is the only downside, but they've got a lot of slows which they can apply to Roshan. It's going to kite him up. It's only a 4-second arrow coming in from Sing Sing, but they just don't know. The A ulti is coming in, but it's going to be way too late because Roshan, he's dead already. Aegis the Immortal goes into the Drow Ranger, quick and executing. Love it from C9.
Yeah, and honestly, I think they should be pushing in. Like, now that they have the maxed out Aura as well as the maxed out Frost Arrows, you've got a lot of damage up on Drow Ranger. As soon as you hit level 11, which you just pick up, now you're hitting, like, a truck already. This should be really your time to keep on fighting over and over again. I think they should be using this Aegis to push down all of the Tier 1s and all of the Tier 2s. I'm saying don't let up for a minute. Just end this right here with this Drow Ranger push.
They're coming for it, man. I'm waiting for just the hovering arrow, but they want to get someone they know they can hit. And with the arrow coming to middle lane, they're going to look for Jiggle Billy. So Sing Sing preps it. The TP's going. The arrow is going to be way too late. The line was right, but he just TP'd bottom lane. They deny the bottom tower. Now this means they've also lost their protection. And Drow Ranger, you know what you do with Drow.
Oh, no. Oh,
she's on the edge. She's on the edge.
Oh, that is so close. Oh, I'm a sheep. If he just kept it going for a little bit longer.
Just a microsecond was all it would take.
Yeah, he would have picked off the Aegis.
Now they go into the Moonlight Shadow.
Yeah, just keep going. Just keep on being aggressive. You have a great damage lineup.
Fishing Arrow, they're going to find one. They found Cakes. Too far out, Grave Chill. They got Soul Assumption damage. No need for the extra stuns. When you got both Grave Chill as well as those Cold Arrows, it's just too much DPS and everyone's getting the buff up too. Remember, you've got 5 range heroes over here on C9. Mm-hmm. Every single one of them has a bonus 42 damage because of the Drow Ranger aura. And then on top of that, Pylai Dai is giving the Vengeance aura. So there's 12% bonus damage coming in to the rest of C9. So they're dishing out so much DPS.
Yeah, don't forget also that you have the reason you see a lot of Visage being picked up with Drow Ranger. I think we've mentioned this before, but the aura is used for the familiars, and think how quickly the familiars auto attack, right? They attack very, very quickly, so even when they do lose their damage, they're still doing a good 50 to 60. She has to activate it if they're global, or if she's close, they do also get it. So it's still, the familiars are actually a really big pushing power.
I was about to say, guys, I'm sure there was some conditions on those, because
yeah.
You're right. You know, I referenced the 2012 kind of time.
Mm-hmm.
That was back in the days when it was permanent.
It was completely, permanent and global, and that was a very ridiculous time where...
The familiars were actually bringing down towers all by themselves.
Yeah, that was an awful time. I saw Visage and Drow Ranger being picked up everywhere, and it was awful.
It basically meant that you could run a Visage as a solo mid.
Yeah, because I was playing support so much at that time, and you just like couldn't do anything. Like familiars are just as fast as you, and they're always hitting like trucks. You just die constantly.
Yeah, and it's amazing how times have changed. But Blink Dagger has now arrived. 15 minutes in, not too bad for Jiggabilly. He managed to find the space, even though he's got 2 deaths to his name. That Blink Dagger has arrived. So now they've finally got the Hallelujah play here for eHug. Mm-hmm. It's not the most amazing Hallelujah play, and they're still going up against even more damage. A Maelstrom pickup for Sing Sing. He's already hitting at over 150 damage with every single hit, and then he brings in Drow Ranger, and we just managed to rack up even higher. The VS, sorry, aura is even higher on him. Mm-hmm. This bottom tower doesn't stand a chance. And with an Eagle Song also on Drow Ranger, man, this agility is getting out of control. Blink in Lasso. They're going to go here on Eternal Envy, but then the swap instantly cancels the Lasso. They've lost their control. The familiars have dropped down too. These guys have come up with some decent damage, and they're thinking about going in. The Moonlight Shadow is there, but there's no big openings. The arrow is coming in from Sing Sing, looking for a hit. It's able to just miss on both the 2 supports there of eHug. But C9 are not going to back out from this, and why should they? with Lasso on cooldown. Bone 7 jumps in. Beautiful. A three-man perfect call. The VS don't make sure Dazzle goes down. The Chrono, it does fly up, but they're not there. RP on three. Skewer going to drag him back in again, but they don't have Eternal Envy. He's sitting on the edge right now. They got a double kill, and this may even be a GG call. When they take out this tier 2 tower and the last hero, look at the DPS of Bone 7. Just from range, it's enough with the puck. But they will go high ground right now and even look towards the Raxing. And this is only 17 minutes into this game. This is the power of Aura Strat, not to mention wonderful controlling initiating heroes from C9.
Yeah, until they fix this whole Draw Ranger Avisage combo, you gotta try and ban that out.
Just learn to like it.
You gotta ban it out. If they pick it up as a combo, as Cloud9 did, as their 1-2, then you have to take away Vengeful Spirit. Like, you can't leave that out of the pool as well. It's just way too much added damage that those familiars are hitting. Pretty much everyone has double damage. When Cloud9 are fully grouped up, Everyone has double damage.
And now on top of that double damage, that is survivability. Yeah. The Vengeful Spirit of all heroes, the one that was just sitting behind Eternal Envy watching him farm, now finishes an entire mech in this game. The other items, which we already talked about, Drow Ranger with the with the Rags going down the bottom lane, he can finish a full butterfly. Like, we're 18 minutes in. With the Mask of Madness, you already got your DPS, so that was just like, I dish out more damage in a shorter time, even though I don't rack up the higher damage points, and I get lifesteal on top of that? Hell yeah. And now, there it is. So, full butterfly is done 18 minutes into this game. And the Eagles will get reclaimed while the rest of C9 are searching for kills. They come underneath sentry wards, however, so they won't really find a good advantage here.
Yeah, the biggest problem right now is, we also have Aghanim's being finished up on Visage. I'm not sure if you said that, but that's an extra, like, just like the added familiar is strong automatically for Visage. It's one of the stronger Aghanim's upgrades, but then you combine it with the aura, and honestly, it's just overwhelming. So that's a big damage increase as well. This game is pretty much over because eHug, while they do have some good late game here, and it's mainly in the fact that Magnus is always strong late game, and he's always good with melee heroes, so being able to give that extra bonus damage to a Faceless Void, it increases his late game potential. He actually is not that strong of a late game. I would classify him more as a mid game carry most of the times. However, when you have a Magnus, you have a lot more late game potential. That being said, it's just not enough. When you're already one racks down pre-20 minutes, that's such a gimp to your gold. Right, you're the flow of gold. Like, not only are you picking up less last hits on that bottom lane, but you're also getting less gold from it. It's just, you're never going to be able to actually get close enough to Cloud9. They're going to be a good 2 to 3 luxury items ahead of you at all times.
Yeah, this is. I want to look on the bright side of eHug right now, but the only thing I could do is give him a hug and just say, there. There is nothing that can be done for them right now.
Just go next. It'll be okay. Just go next. Yeah, it's pretty rough. I mean, they do have this whole entire combo, so they're probably going to wait out one more team fight when Cloud9 go pick up Aegis, go middle, and try and take Arax. That's when they're going to try and hit their big RP Faceless Void with extra damage.
That's going to have to be like the worst positioning from C9 in the history of Dota in order for eHug to get a good fight off here. Like, and even then, they're going to have another Aegis the Immortal. Like, Roshan's timer is about to kick over, and it's even a short timer, too. It's only going to be 20 seconds. It's only going to be 20 seconds on the extra time. And, they're just going to wait for it. Look at Sing Sing, that high Mr. Phase Brute's movement speed, walking around with his Yasha. He dishes out so much DPS. And the second he arrives, Roshan, look, they just leave the courier to scout for it. Roshan's up. They go inside the pit and then push down middle. This should be the goal right now of C9. They could think about the top lane, though, just for the purpose of having eHug so split up. But here comes Envy. He's got 2.5k. Look at the DPS to Roshan, man! Like, this is just two heroes! But he's hitting at about 300 damage per attack coming out from Envy. He'll pick up the Aegis Immortal, but I'm almost wondering right now if he should sell the TB Scroll and pick up a Demon Edge as well.
Yeah, I mean, it's so early on. Like, you look at Drow Ranger's DPS, it's pretty impressive.
Here he comes. TP Scroll. Envy. Like, he just bought something else. He bought an Ultimate Orb.
Okay.
Okay. It looks like we're gonna go a little bit more standard and go into the Manta style.
Yeah, the faster you can take down the buildings, faster this game's gonna end. Well, Battlefear is now up for power net, so he's gonna be able to get a lot of
nothing.
Get a lot of cleave action going on.
A lot of
on.
Nothing.
Get a lot of cleave action. So if you do hit the big RP,
you got Jiggle Billy giving him empower anyway. You didn't need the cleave action from the Battle Fury. I'm just saying. This is, yeah.
It's, yeah. I personally would have preferred a Maelstrom because you know you were going to have to fight early, but.
Familius! Oh, Blink Skewer! That's going to miss as well. The tower goes down. Draw Ranger is taking minimal damage here. And then one arrow! Holy Hannah! That's just not cool! Jiggle Billy is just flashing over on the sidelines here. And they know Draw Ranger can sit in the front lines because she still has Aegis the Immortal. So you initiate on her and you lose everything. The arrow comes in, avoids everything, and the mid ranks is completely uncontested. Now the jump in from Bone 7 balls up the Dream Coil. And then, well, there's no swap effects. A great chrono. But then Bone 7, he tanked up just long enough to cause some troubles, and with a VS swap, there's no problems whatsoever. RP is really, really nice. And now in comes Palnet. Starts to cleave him up and does a lot of damage here, but the arrow from Sing Sing, he sits on the low ground, Envy's back to life again, Gustamon splits him up completely. Pandago gets destroyed by these arrows. And that is GG. 13-4 at the end of this game. Jiggle Billy will help feed all of the multi-kill prizes over to the people who bought the MLG TKO ticket. But C9, they're looking beautifully strong this evening. And that strat's scary. That strat's really, really scary.
A 5-range strat that has the synergy between the aura. I mean, we talked about the Draw Ranger with the Puck and the Marana. Like, that's really good synergy. You combine the Visage Familiars as well. Then you get another aura in the Vengeful Spirit. Like, honestly, there are very, very few things. I don't think there were pretty much any bans that eHug threw down that Cloud9 were upset about. I think they would have, I think Lycan, honestly, would be a good addition to this kind of strategy, but this is much earlier push strat and a lot more early fighting power than a Lycan would give you. So instead of running that, run like, you know, Puck and Marana, just really good fighters early on. Sure, they're very, very squishy if they get initiated on, but you look at the first two supports coming out from eHug, Dazzle and an Ancient Apparition, they weren't going to be able to punish those squishy heroes at all.
Yeah, agreed, man, agreed. Game number two, though, will be coming up in a moment, people, so stay tuned. We're doing the MLG TKO tournament. For all the details of the event, head yourself over to mlg.joindota.com, and you can follow through Group 1 all the way here into Group 2 as we're doing our doubleheader for Cloud9. They're going up first here, eHug, who is sitting currently in fourth position, and then they go up against Team Liquid, who are sitting undefeated so far in the group, but they've only played through one set of their matches. So Team Liquid, gonna be looking to see if they can keep their winning streak running and maybe join EG in that top podium and contest Cloud9 and not say, we're not number three, we could be number two, well, we can be number one.
You know about all the stuff that's been going on with Team Liquid now.
So
maybe there are changes on the way for Spluff and stuff regains his captain position.
I messaged Bulba about this and they said, yo, man, like, just simply, have you sorted your shit? And he's like, yeah. We didn't want it to go down the way that shits got sorted. So
yeah, I think you probably messaged him after. He was supposed to come on a cast with me, and he was like, I got a team meeting to go to. I was like, I completely understand, man. I totally understand. Go do you, you know?
All right, break time, peoples. We've still got one more game here of eHug going up against Cloud9, so stay tuned, and we'll be back.